welcome to the Heartful Parent Podcast. I'm your host, Christy Keating. In this podcast, we talk about it all, our parenting, our partnering, and our professional lives, because they are all a part of us, and we were never meant to do this alone. Welcome back to the Heartful Parent Podcast, everyone. I hope you are doing well wherever you are listening to this. And if you are a celebrator of American Thanksgiving, I hope you had a great Thanksgiving break. I hope you got some time off. I hope it was low stress. I know that might be a tall order for many of us, but I hope you are feeling a little bit rejuvenated as we head into the remainder of the holiday season and sort of all that that entails, regardless of where you are in the world or what you celebrate or how you celebrate it. So this week, as promised, we have Christine Muenz back on the podcast. We started this conversation with her 2 weeks ago. So listeners, if you did not hear part one of my conversation with Christine, I would suggest that you pause this here, go back to the platform that you listen to podcasts on, back it up 2 weeks and listen to part one. You will get a lot more out of today's conversation if you have the foundation for what we're talking about and if you just understand the kind of fun and kooky dynamic between Christine and I. If you don't want to do that or you're joining us for round two, just as a reminder, Christine, who is a colleague and a dear friend, is also a parenting educator, a lactation educator, an infant feeding specialist. And I met her because she teaches classes at a Seattle area hospital where I was a student initially many years ago. And Christine also lectures at conferences for professionals who work with pregnant and postpartum families. She is nationally known in the US for her work with pregnant and postpartum families and feeding and, you know, making sure that those families and mamas are getting what they need. In the first part of this conversation, she and I kind of dug into this idea about food and our, you know, the way that we feed our kids, the relationship that that has, you know, lifelong relationship that that creates for our relationship with food and our bodies and all of that. And as you may recall, assuming you listened to part one, Christine and I can like zigzag and go down all the rabbit holes, and we tried to keep it somewhat focused. But in today's episode, which is really part two of my conversation with Christine, we're going to kind of continue the discussion. We're going to dig into some additional questions and really explore kind of how this all plays out in our daily lives. And, you know, how we can make maybe better choices than we have been for our kiddos and ourselves around food and bodies and all of that. So I hope you get a lot out of this. Again, if you are returning from episode one and have, you know, listened to episode one, you'll know that Christine and I have so many things to say about so many things. And so I look forward to having her back on the pod and, you know, really honoring the title that I gave her in the first part of this conversation, which is Friend of the Pod. So if you enjoy the dynamic with Christine and I, please reach out, let us know. You can send me an email at christy@theheartfulparent.com. And Christine is starting to sort of branch out and do private work outside of the other organizations that she works for. And you can find her at christinemuenz.com. All right, without further ado, part two. So I have a bunch of questions that are sort of rattling around for me, and I'm going to throw them all out and then we'll just kind of go where we want to go. Okay. But I mean, one of them is we have had another guest who talked about feeding and sort of talked about that the division of labor, maybe not so helpful sometimes. So I'd love to have you kind of talk about, you know, from your perspective, how does that, all of that play together? And then I'd love to also, you know, because we prefaced this conversation
how does this all play into the bigger picture of body image and self-love and this really, you know, fucked up culture that tells us things about the way we should look that are just not fair.
I sort of feel like this whole conversation is about the relationship with food.
Yeah.
And that maybe we need to have a whole second conversation.
Let's do it.
About the body image thing. Because there's still a lot to say about the food thing. I can hear the people listening to this in their car screaming at their screaming at both of us right now, mostly me. They have to eat vegetables. They have to, you know. And I also know that temperament is real. And every single thing that I have said that I taught you when you sat in my classes with your oldest worked great with her. Mm-hmm. And you could have done the exact same thing with your youngest. And because she's a different person, it won't work. I go back to what I started with at the very beginning, which is parenting is not policy and procedure. Yeah. There is not one right way to do this. I am never going to argue with a parent who tells me, you know, Christine, it's actually really working at our house if we tell them they have to take a thank you bite. And we're not having battles of will and nobody's mad and nobody's digging their heels in. It works at our house. Then I'm going to say, amazing, continue doing, please take a thank you bite. You know, daddy, yep. Daddy worked hard making this meal. Let's show him our appreciation by everybody is going to at least try it.
Yeah. You know? And I will say my youngest will try everything. Mm-hmm. And that's not a battle that we fight. And she'll even say, yummy. And then we'll be like, oh, that's what you eat. And I probably shouldn't comment, right? Mm-hmm. We'll say, oh, yeah, it is yummy, isn't it? And then she won't eat another bite because she's making the monkeys dance.
Right. And also, she has an older sibling who gets a lot of attention and has a big personality. And is enough older that her activities and her homework and her friends and her big feelings are topics of conversation in the house that take a lot of the oxygen out of the Keating household.
True.
What a fantastic way to make no one pay attention to my beloved older sister.
Who she worships.
Who we all kind of worship.
Yeah.
She's amazing.
She's pretty great.
But right, this is so common for the youngest to be the one who is a little bit more picky eater. Again, I'm using air quotes, or has a little bit more behavior challenges at the table. So maybe it's just throwing their plate or purposefully dropping their cup on the floor or whatever. You know, a lot of times it is a great way to get some attention. Mm-hmm. So first of all, I'm not going to argue with a parent when they tell me something's working at their house. Amazing. Do what works at your house.
Yes. Cause that's mm-hmm. a classic example of there are really truly a million different ways
yep.
to be a fantastic,
parent.
And if that is working, fabulous.
Generally, the people who come to my classes for feeding your toddler or who ask for a one-on-one session with me because of feeding challenges with an older child, things are not working at their
right.
house. And so that's, you know, where a lot of this comes from.
Yeah.
And if you are worried that, gosh, the only thing that my child has eaten in a couple of days is the protein and the starch. She ate the chicken and the rice. She ate a hamburger and a bun. She ate, you know, whatever. She ate the chili, but she's, again, didn't eat the salad. It's okay to put in some gateway vegetable that you know she will eat as a way to get her unstuck from the not interested in vegetable. Mm-hmm. Just don't talk about it. You know, I could always count on broccoli. You know, when I was worried about one or the other of my kids being in a phase where they had just weren't doing a great job with eating the salad or eating the vegetables, I could always count on Caesar salad and broccoli.
Yeah.
And so that was a way back in. And so sometimes it would even be, okay, I'm making Brussels sprouts tonight. I don't know that anybody's going to eat these Brussels sprouts, so I'm also going to make broccoli. And just, and don't talk about it. These are, again, I'm doing my job. This is the division of labor. I decide what, when, and where. And tonight we're having salmon and Brussels sprouts and broccoli. And again, if your kid only eats the salmon, that's okay. They did their job. Tomorrow, they're going to have a bunch of fruit with their breakfast because a lot of the same nutrients you can get in vegetables, you can get in fruits. And so sometimes when a kid is in a phase where they're not doing great with their vegetables, we're just giving them extra fruits. Some of you, I'm sure, are finding your way around this by making green smoothies at your house and putting a handful of kale and spinach in your blender with a banana and some frozen berries. This, by the way, is one of my favorite tips for kids that were really concerned about their protein intake. So sometimes kids with some special needs or some sensory processing challenges are the ones that were really worried about food aversions, and it's a real challenge to get enough protein in them. My favorite is a green smoothie with a scoop of protein powder in it. And there are some really good ones on the market now. And sometimes you can even get them to eat one with a scoop of peanut butter in it as well. It's like a peanut butter and jelly sandwich smoothie. What a great food and a way to get some healthy food into your kid, but just don't hide it. That's the thing that I think is a slippery slope, is when people say, oh, I'm not going to let him know I put a handful of kale or some spinach or some berries in there. I'm going to call it a milkshake and I'm not going to let him know he's eating vegetables. No, you know, let him help you make the smoothie and let him throw in the berries and the peanut butter and the handful of spinach.
Okay. I'm so glad you said that, because there is actually a cookbook out, probably more than one, but a cookbook out, who the wife of a celebrity who is all, it's the whole thing. I don't have it, but from what I understand, it's all about hiding
vegetables
into things, right?
The whole premise is, if you hide the healthy food in foods they already like, then they'll be eating the healthy food. But you hit it. If you put a handful of kale in your spaghetti sauce, like she recommends, and then you blend it with an immersion blender, yay, your kids got kale. But your kids have no idea that they eat kale. And then when you come to our picnic, because we're going to host a picnic and invite y'all. And we serve some,
I'm sorry,
we are. Did I forget to tell you?
Yeah.
There's a big calendar behind me. I'll put it on there. Anyway, I just think it's important for kids to know what they're eating, know where food comes from. Let them help you choose food at the grocery store. Let them help you make food.
And that is part of what, like when we, again, in the world of positive parenting and positive discipline, it's not just like the foundation of it isn't just connection, but also mutual respect, the idea of mutual respect. And I would be frankly fairly pissed off if somebody put something they know I don't like. So I, for example, I cannot stand olives.
Really? How do we not know that about each other?
I don't know. Oh, that makes me so happy because usually like everyone's like, you don't like olives? What's wrong with you?
I like olives are the worst.
Oh, they're the worst. And they make me want to throw up. And, but if somebody took olives and like ground them up and put them in something without telling me to try to get me to eat them, I'd be pissed. That does not feel respectful.
Right.
Like if my husband did that to me, we'd have a big old fight about it.
Yeah. So, and then he was like, ha ha, you ate tapenade.
Right.
You loved it.
Right.
Yeah.
Thank God Jonas doesn't like olives either, but so he wouldn't do it. But like, that's not respectful behavior. And yet we have a whole like cookbook designed to do that to our kids, to be sneaky to our kids.
Yeah.
Mutual respect, I think, is something that we can all bear in mind in all aspects of our parenting. You know, and it's so, side note, so interesting, because I was talking about this a couple of months ago with some clients, and it was the first time I kind of introduced that concept. These particular clients had come from a very traditional background, very authoritarian style of parenting, where the parents deserve the respect, but don't really, it's the whole idea that respect is earned. I subscribe to the idea that we're all deserving of respect. I'll start out from a place of respect, and then you can make me lose my respect for you,
mm-hmm.
right? First, outside of parenting, right? We should always respect our own children. But I just think that's such an interesting concept that's so foreign to many parents, because we were not raised
exactly
in families where that idea of mutual loving respect, that's the foundation along with connection, right?
And it's exactly what I meant when I said we all bring to the table the way we were raised.
Yeah.
And so, for example, I was raised in a house where you got a lot of praise and positive strokes for being a clean plater and being mm-hmm. in a clean plate club. And, you know, my dad wasn't a super effusive guy. He didn't heap a bunch of praise on you, but by eating food, you could get a lot of attention from my dad and go, way to go. What a good eater. And you're in the clean plate club and, you know, all that kind of stuff. And then, you know, my sister and I joked at some point that we had spent the better part of our adult lives trying to learn how to stop eating when we were satisfied.
Yeah.
Because both of us had been taught that you just keep eating until it is gone. And we live in a culture that has just gross portion sizes. Mm-hmm. And so we, you know, we would go to a restaurant and get served a salad the size of, you know, my head.
Yeah.
Or both of our heads.
Yeah.
And then I would just keep eating and eating and eating, even though I was full. And how many times, I'm sure you and I are not the only ones, you know, on this listening today, who have like pushed yourself away from the table, uncomfortably full, but we just kept eating because it was in front of us. Well, guess where that comes from? That comes from giving kids lots and lots of praise for eating, for being a clean plater. It comes from making them finish food in order to get to the dessert that they were super excited about, because they helped you make those brownies and brownies are yummy. And the only way I'm going to get a brownie is to keep shoveling this food in.
Mm-hmm.
Also, another part of this conversation is portion size. A lot of us are giving our kids way more food than they actually need, and then we're shocked that they didn't eat all of it. This always comes up when we're talking about toddlers, preschoolers, and really young kids, that if you make a turkey sandwich for your three-year-old and you cut it into like little strips or whatever, you know what the portion of bread is for a toddler?
I feel like you told me this once, like a quarter of a piece of bread.
A quarter of a piece of bread. The portion of the meat is like a tablespoon of meat. The portion of vegetables is 1 to 2 tablespoons of vegetables. So if you make a turkey sandwich and some apple slices for your kiddo, and he eats 3 bites of that turkey sandwich and 1 apple slice, a toddler, a preschooler, he did his job and got full portions of bread, cheese, turkey, mm-hmm. and the fruit. But we're looking at the 2/3 of the sandwich that are still sitting there and the 5 apple slices that he didn't eat and going, he's not getting enough food. He's not.
Yeah.
All right.
I want to bring you back.
Okay.
I want to bring you back because I want to finish up the conversation about kids who are sensitive.
Mm.
So this is a spectrum, as many things are, right?
Yes.
So there are families who have kids who are on the autism spectrum, right? Yep. There are, you know, kids with ADHD, and then there's like sensory processing yep. stuff. And like, I just don't like the texture that of this, right? Okay. So how does this division of labor and all of that play together?
And it just goes exactly into your conversation about respect. So here's a story from my child who...
Wisdom keeper.
My kiddo was a fantastic eater, would eat whatever we put in front of him. He gobbled it up. And then when I served it a couple of nights later as leftovers, he wouldn't eat it.
I hate leftovers.
And okay, well, there you go.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, buddy, you love spaghetti and meatballs. You gobbled this up 2 days ago. Why won't you eat it? And he couldn't explain or articulate. He just didn't want it. And I was like mad. And gosh, You guys, it's hard to feed a family. And some of you have more than one child and you're trying to feed yourself and your partner, and we have jobs and oh my gosh, nobody's walked the dog. And now this kid won't eat leftovers and that kid won't eat green food. And it is exhausting. And so yeah. I wasn't coming from a very maybe nice place or respectful place in my parenting. And I would say things like, you like this. You ate it 2 days ago. Just eat it. That's good. And finally, one day he had enough language to explain to me that meat tastes different when you reheat it. And you know what? He's right.
He's totally, I'm so with him on this.
Yes.
I will actually eat like a pasta or a soup or something that's reheated. Mm-hmm. But if you try to give me reheated meat,
yep.
I will not eat it.
That was, and so mm-mm. once he could articulate that, it's not that I don't want to eat this meatball. I would rather eat it cold. And sure enough, he's the kid who would eat cold spaghetti or like Thanksgiving leftovers. You know how amazing Thanksgiving leftovers are the mm-hmm. next day and all that? You're not heating that up for him. He doesn't want potatoes and gravy and stuffing and stuff like that. He just wants a turkey sandwich and, you know, so keep it cold, whatever. So once he could explain that to me, and I looked at my three kids and my partner and I sitting at the table, and I'm like, you know what? He is the one who is sensitive enough to changes in taste or changes in texture that he just couldn't choke it down, reheat it. And so I became a lot more respectful of who he mm-hmm. was and not expecting him to devour the leftovers. And so now that doesn't mean we're not having leftovers. That's, you know, I can't stand food waste and we're on a budget and all this, but on leftovers night, this kiddo, I am going to make sure that I make a Caesar salad that night that we're having leftovers, because he will eat his weight in Caesar salad.
Yeah.
And I'm going to make sure, you know, for another kid, maybe it's tonight we're going to have crudité. You know, I'm going to cut up lots of carrots and celery and radishes and red bell peppers and have a big thing of hummus on the table for dipping it into, because you might know that your child has real aversions to when all the ingredients are. A lot of sensitive kids don't like food where everything is in one, like in a lasagna.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Or yep. a stew or a soup or some chili. And so if that's your kid, but you know that they'll eat crudité and hummus, that's the mental math I'm willing to do, is to, it's still, as far as the division of labor, I'm doing my job. I'm deciding what is offered. But I know that my kid who's sensitive about mixing textures, or my kid who doesn't like reheated food, or just don't reheat the leftovers and let them have it cold.
Right.
But what you didn't hear me say is I'm going to go make chicken dinosaurs or mac and cheese
yes.
for that kid, because that is a slippery slope. Every time you say, oh, he won't eat anything that I'm serving tonight, I'll go make something separate for him, you are reinforcing the behavior. And
yeah.
that's how you can end up with a 9-year-old who only eats three things.
Well, I worked with a family a number of years ago, and mom was absolutely exhausted. And it came to light that she was making, now I can't remember if it was 4 or 5 completely different meals 3 times a day.
Yeah.
And it was during the pandemic. And so everybody was at home. I think it was 4 different meals at every meal. That's 12 meals a day that she was cooking. And yeah. Oh my gosh. It's right. Like, it's no wonder she was exhausted.
That for any of you, I don't want, it is, again, it is so hard to be responsible for feeding a family. And even if you and your partner are sharing it equally, sharing the conception, planning, and execution of feeding this family so that we are splitting the groceries.
It's a little fair play there.
Yeah. And it's yeah. like, you know, I love me some fair play.
Yep.
That, you know, we're sharing the grocery shopping, we're sharing the meal planning, we're sharing the cooking, we're sharing the cleaning. Even if it is a 50-50 split at your house, it is still exhausting.
Yeah.
And trying to figure out how to get nutritious, healthy, local, organic, in season, you know, all of those things, foods into this family when we've all got likes and dislikes mm-hmm. is exhausting.
Yeah. I want to go back for a minute because I do love me some fair play. Also, nobody has 50-50, and that's not the goal of fair play, right?
No, clearly.
Right. But I want to also say that with the, you know, not being a short order cook, the furthest that I will go is deconstructing a meal. Mm-hmm. So like, you know, like the kids that don't like it all mixed together. Mm-hmm. So my younger one doesn't like a lot of sauces. Mm-hmm. So we will like cook the pasta and give her plain pasta, which I got to tell you, it kills me. I hate it, but we'll give her that. And then maybe we will take the pieces apart, or if we're making something that is what she calls it spicy, which I think of spicy as hot, like to the tongue. For her, spicy is just, it has flavor.
Flavorful.
Yeah. It has flavor. Yeah. So we will leave the flavor out in as much as we can and give her the pieces. You know, and if she needs to eat bland food, okay, but she'll, anyway.
Yeah.
So we do that. Okay. So I want to shift gears just a little bit. Again, you and I are recording this 4 days after Halloween. And okay, both of my kids trick-or-treated this year. My 14-year-old is like not willing to give this up. Fine. Great. Love it.
I think that's amazing.
I think it's amazing too. I mean, I think it's amazing. And I love that she did that and loves it. Mm-hmm. She and my younger one got more candy than the older one. And that was an interesting to watch the dynamic between the two of them. But suffice it to say, they both have two enormous Ziploc bags full of candy on the counter. And the healthy part of me wants to be like, let's like have it for a week or a couple pieces or whatever. And then let's like throw the rest away or donate it or whatever. Mm-hmm. And we're coming up on Thanksgiving, which you were describing, like the people that like push themselves back from the table because they can't eat another bite. Well, that's like most of the United States Thanksgiving, and maybe Canada too on their Thanksgiving. Mm-hmm. And then we've got like holiday after holiday, right? And like right now, again, when we're recording it, it's Diwali in the Indian community, which I know there's food involved in that celebration. And we are, you know, then we're coming up on Christmas and Hanukkah and Kwanzaa and New Year's and there's a lot of like traditional foods that families enjoy.
But listen to the way you're talking about this, Christy. Every single thing you just said is about connection, togetherness, joy, love, celebration, family, tradition. Those are all great, amazing things about the holidays and the food associated with holidays. So why would you want to ruin any of that by having battles of will, by labeling our kids picky eater? They will live up to what we say about them. So if you call your kids picky, get ready for them to prove it to grandma.
Yeah.
By not eating any of the food that she brought, you know, for the celebration.
100%. And I want to flip that question on its head.
Okay.
Because what if the, you know, listeners out there are like, my kid's not picky. Mm-hmm. My kid will eat all of it. Mm-hmm. That my kid and I will be my teenager, if we would let her, would probably take that bag of Halloween candy up to her bedroom and it would be gone in 4 days, right? Mm-hmm. She would devour it. And that's where I think, you know, especially with the older kids, and there may be parents listening to this who are thinking, shit, I screwed it up, right? Like I've gotten into these battles and, or I've like, you know, in some way or another encouraged my child to eat more than they should, or I've modeled eating more than I should, whatever messaging. First of all, I want to have everybody take a deep breath and give yourself some grace, right? But for those parents who are like, I'm worried about how much my child is eating and that's not a healthy relationship with food. And how do I, and here's the big word, right? How do I control that? Right. What do I do about that so that I'm sending good messages, but not screwing my kid up, but also being mindful of their health.
Right.
Because I think, you know, and Julie Ziva was one of my guests on the podcast and she talked about feeding and sort of, I think I got some questions about, well, like, do we just let them eat whatever they want? And I know that's not the division of labor at play there, but talk to us a little bit about that.
I want to empower my child to listen to their body and eat when they're hungry and stop when they're satisfied. And over time, they'll realize that when they put healthy foods in their body, they have more energy, they feel better, that, you know, all of that. I want all of that. Also, Reese's are delicious.
Oh my God. Yes.
Right. And so they want to sit there and dump out their little pumpkin head and shovel in all of these things. And this is one of those things that great, great professionals have big differences of opinions on. I mean, I have a couple of my very favorite RDs and feeding specialists who I follow and who I read all of their stuff, who have very different opinions on this. And there's this kind of one school of thought that is, if you limit things, if you make things forbidden, you the research is good.
I want all the shit I can't have.
That's right. Yep. Oh, that's exactly right. And so if you make it forbidden, often your kid is much more likely to binge on it when they are not in your care or at home. Mm-hmm. So as soon as they go to someone else's house, they are shoveling in the Reese's. As soon as they go to school where there's a vending machine, they are spending all of their babysitting money on Reese's and jamming them in and, or whatever the thing is, you know, soda or so. That sort of school of thought is, don't make it forbidden. In the same way that earlier I said, don't set up a hierarchy of food and talk about how like carbs are my enemy. Sugar's not my enemy. Processed food isn't my enemy. It's just not the best for me, right?
Right.
This is highly processed food. It doesn't have a whole lot of ingredients that appear in nature. So I want to have less of it. And when we talk about health with our kids, we can be talking about how it gives you energy, it helps you grow, it makes it so that you are going to sleep better or you don't have a tummy ache, or, you know, if you have a kid who has trouble pooping, you know, these conversations come up. Well, let's make sure that we're eating some green food because green food helps us poop, or let's have some fruit and fruit helps us poop, right? Let's make sure that we're eating foods that give us energy because you have soccer after school today. So, you know, those are ways to talk about food, not
totally weight neutral ways.
Right. You didn't hear me say anything about this is going to help you be lean or, right. You know, right. This is, you can say things like this is good for your muscles and you need a lot of muscles at soccer today. So, you know, or this food helps us see in the dark. This is really good for our eyes. You know, you could say things like that, but that's not about being a particular size and it's not judgmental of people whose bodies look different than ours. So, okay, that's one school of thought. Don't make it forbidden. Don't make it a hierarchy of things. And then just talk about it in moderation. In the same way that I don't want you to eat 2 pounds of cherries, right? Cherries, amazing. Whole food appears in nature. Lots of good things for you. Christy, I'm not going to let you eat 2 pounds of cherries because that is going to give you a stomach ache and diarrhea. And I love you and I don't want that.
That is going nowhere good.
So also, I'm not going to let you eat all 57 Reese's that you got in our neighborhood. And so moderation.
Mom.
Babe, don't worry. I'm not throwing them away. And if you want to meter out this giant pumpkin head full of candy over the next 5 months, fine. But so a lot of families will just moderation. We're going to set some limits on 2 pieces a day or 3 pieces a day or whatever, however you want to do it. At every meal. I mean, I don't care. There's not a right way. To me, that always made sense.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you what, I have 2 of my 3 kids who after the first week or two, totally forgot about Halloween candy because they just didn't care that much about it. And my other kid woke up in the morning and couldn't think of anything else except what his 3 pieces of candy were going to be until it was gone. Temperament is real.
Oh my God.
That kid, I'm not kidding you. He would wake up in the morning, come downstairs and go, today I'm going to have a Kit Kat, 100 grand and a Snickers. And I'm like, way to go, bud.
Oh my God. That will be my little one. She loves to tell me how much she loves sugar. And she every night, and so we have an au pair who lives with us And then, you know, my older daughter, so there's usually five of us at the dinner table, and we have all gotten to the point where we can predict with precision. Maren will say, I have two questions. And the first question is always, may I please be excused? Mm-hmm. And the second question is, may I please have dessert? Every night she wants to make sure that we're, and if we're not having dessert, mm-hmm. you know, which oftentimes we don't, or,
yeah, it's not a part of the family meal tonight.
Right. That is a bad day in her world.
Oh,
that's a bad day in her world. And she doesn't have very many bad days, but you know, she's one of those kids that's pretty happy-go-lucky, but mm-hmm. man, can you send her down the, you know, my life is hard hole if she doesn't get dessert.
And also I feel seen by Maren because, you know, it's hard on the days that my favorite show hasn't dropped on Netflix yet. Ugh, why do I have to wait till Friday for another episode of Great British Baking Show? You know, it's hard. Sometimes things are hard. That's okay. Mm-hmm. I see, I hear, I understand. I know you talk about emotion coaching and validating your feelings. That doesn't mean you go make brownies just because she's having a hard day.
Right.
The
what's the other school?
Not, right. Are the people who say, just let them be in charge of their own bodies. There is nothing different about candy than there is about potatoes or salmon. And if you would let her eat as much salmon as she wants, then you should also let her eat as many Reese's as she wants. And I just told you about the difference in temperament of my kids. With my daughter, I could 100% just say, have at it, kid. We don't set any limits on your Halloween candy. She's just not a candy snarfer, you know? And so she would eat one or two pieces and she would forget about it. With my oldest, he would have eaten the whole bag in 2 days.
Yeah.
And then he would be bent over and have diarrhea and, I mean, be miserable and couldn't go to school. And so as a mother, that school of thought didn't really work for me with the temperament of my oldest child.
You know, what's really interesting to me about both of those schools of thought is there's a lot of overlap. Like they're very similar in some ways, because in neither one of these are we saying you may not have the candy,
right?
Or I'm going to, you know, tightly control it and dole out whatever. And then, you know, when it's 1 week gone, then the pumpkin fairy or whatever is going to take your damn candy. It's the like, don't restrict it too much because they'll want more, but we're going to talk about it in relation to our body, you know, just like eating part of a healthy diet overall. And then the other one is let them have at it and do what they're going to do. But either way, they're getting the candy and we are not exerting excessive levels of control.
The other thing I think we haven't mentioned on this is I have a lot of empathy for the parent who is listening to this and saying, I can't have that candy in my house for my own health.
Yeah.
And because of our own relationship with food, for some of us, it is, if I have that candy in this house, I will eat all of it. And then I'll have a shame spiral and self-loathing and all that. And so I respect you as well. And I'm not going to tell you that it is, you know, I'm using air quotes this is not a visual medium, but I'm not going to tell you you're a bad parent if you say we keep the candy in our house for 2 days and then the great pumpkin comes and brings my kid a truck and takes the candy. If that is what works best at your house, great.
I just want you to be
careful about the way you talk about it so that you don't make it sound like the reason we're getting rid of this candy is that it's bad or it's forbidden or that it's, you know, that hierarchy of foods.
Or because I'm so fat which is a nice segue for a future episode, mm-hmm. right? Into this idea of how does all of this play into what we talked about at the very beginning, which is all the messed up messaging, the fact that you and I were sitting here, we're recording a podcast that is, as you said, not a visual medium.
We don't like our profile.
But we don't like the way we look at the camera, right? Like all of this sort of messed up, you know, messaging and how we help our children like in those, you know, older child and into the teen years, continue to develop a healthy relationship with their bodies. Mm-hmm. And as a, you know, I remember going through high school with a dear friend who struggled with anorexia. You know, I know my daughter has friends who are struggling with eating challenges and disorders, mm-hmm. Disordered eating. Mm-hmm. And I know many of us as adults struggle mm-hmm. with disordered eating.
Yep.
So I think that's, I mean, if y'all haven't figured this out yet, Christine and I can talk.
Yeah. I have no idea how long we've been talking, but I feel like we didn't even scratch the surface of everything we wanted to talk about.
No, not even close. But I think we're going to let the people take a break and get what they've gotten in these, what, you know, two episodes and start there. And then, because as I said, Christine, or as many beloved people call her, Miss Teen. because I've announced, you know, she's wearing the imaginary crown that says she's a friend of the podcast. Yeah. She'll be back. She'll be back.
Friend of the pod.
Christine, thank you.
Thank you. What a delight. Oh my gosh. And lovely parents who are listening, give yourselves some grace. You are doing the hardest thing in the world. And if you are sitting here going, man, I want to undo every way we talk about food in our house, just start small. Just maybe try to love your body and not talk about a hierarchy of foods this week. And, you know, just not talk about components, you know, about carbs and protein, but instead just talk about food. Just talk about salmon and chicken and oranges, and, you know.
I mean, this is like everything in life, right? It's easier when we start with some baby steps. Like you said, starting small.
Yep. Give yourself grace. You're not going to be perfect. None of us are going to be perfect because we live in a culture that has a lot of really messed up messages about
food. And I don't know a single human, man, woman, non-binary, who doesn't walk into this conversation about food without their own baggage. We all have baggage around this.
Yep.
So be kind to yourself, be kind to your children. And as we march forth into, you know, what is often called holiday season, enjoy, celebrate, and focus on connection. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Christine.
My pleasure.
All right, everyone. I hope that conversation was helpful, informative, thought-provoking, you know, maybe helped you think about things in a different way or gave you a different perspective or sort of different insight into the conversation that I had a number of episodes with registered dietitian Julie Ziva. I think there's a lot of points of agreement between Julie and Christine, and also some points of, you know, sort of disagreement or just a different perspective on all of this. And the beautiful thing about parenting, as Christine shared in the first part of our conversation, is that, you know, parenting is not policy and procedure. So, you know, I see my job as the host of this podcast to share good information with qualified professionals that is, you know, evidence-based. And then you get to decide what you do with that information. So hope you had fun. Christine and I certainly had fun. She will certainly be back on the podcast in the future. And in the meantime, I'll see you next week for another episode of the Heartful Parent Podcast. Cheers, everyone.